Father, we entrust our time to you tonight. We pray that we would understand more of your truth, see more of your person, understand more of your purposes. We pray this for the glory of your Son, our Savior. Amen. Well, let's have a couple of people help passing these out so that you've got a track to run on if you're trying to take notes. And so I'll just do a song and dance or something when they are passing those out. Tonight, we're going to continue kind of an introduction. So next week, we'll start into the book of Revelation itself in terms of walking our way through it. But we're taking time to do this kind of introduction to lay some groundwork. And even though it's always a little frustrating, you'd like to jump right in, there's some things that if we look at them and sort of get some common language and understanding will give us a good place to continue. Now, if you have your Bible, let's turn to Revelation chapter 1. And we'll be coming back to this chapter in a little bit, but let me just read at various points through the chapter. Verse 1 of chapter 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his servants the things that must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John. The word servant is actually slave. It's a stronger word than simply the word servant. Who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. Blessed are those who hear and keep what is written in it, for the time is near. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia. Verse 9, I, John, your brother, and partner in the tribulation and kingdom and patience, endurance that are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a voice like a trumpet saying, write what you see in a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergamum, to Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. Verse 19, write therefore the things that you have seen, those that are, and those that are to take place after this. And then there's a concluding verse, but we'll not read it at this particular time. Now, last week we looked at the book of Revelation 2 weeks ago, and I'll just probably say last week, I mean last time, so bear with me. At this particular point. Last time, we looked at the book to try and get an overview. So let me just go back and remind you of that. There's a kind of rough outline that it's at the top of page, or top of the sheet. And I call it a rough outline because it's kind of a work in progress with me. As I go through the book of Revelation after a long time, I've looked and I noticed one set of notes and I had one outline and another one a little bit later and it was refined a little bit and I'm reworking this one. But I'm not reworking the book. This is somewhat how the book's together, and it's just a matter of how we present it. So, first of all, the first 8 verses are very simply the introduction. And we noticed last week that the introduction is balanced by a conclusion. Chapter 22, verses 6 to the end of the chapter. And the conclusion and the introduction, if we had time, and maybe we'll take it next week, there's an interesting connection between the two. Many of the things he says in the first 8 verses, he repeats and comes back to again as he concludes. It's just a kind of general introduction to the book. Then you'll notice when we get to verse 9 and we read it, he talks about being in the Spirit on the Lord's day and having a vision. So there's a certain sense in which the visions of the book begin in chapter 1 and verse 9, as John is on the island of Patmos and he is there banished because of his testimony to Jesus, as he says, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. And then he has this vision. And the first part of the vision is a vision of the Lord Jesus. It's a very, and it kind of introduces us to the book, it's a very impressionistic kind of, I've seen somebody try to draw this vision, and it's utterly grotesque. It's not one of those ones where the whole is greater than the parts. In this one, the parts are all greater than the whole, because individually it just is weird if you try and put it all together. But he's pointing out, it's a dramatic way of saying things about Christ in a kind of picture way. But we read verse 19. Let me read it again to you. At the end of having this great vision of Christ, he hears this command from the Lord Jesus. Write, therefore, the things that you have seen. Well, that can only refer to the vision at this point that he's had in this chapter. The things, those that are, and those that are to take place after this. Now, in chapter 4 and verse 1, he says, after this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven, and the first voice which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this. So, the after this part of the book begins in chapter 4 and verse 1. Going back to chapter 1 and verse 19, the things that you have seen, that has to refer to what's in chapter 1 and the vision he's just had. The things which are, he writes, or the Lord Jesus writes through John, letters to seven churches. And so chapters 2 and 3 are the things that are, describing the state of the churches, and we'll walk our way through those in due course. So one simple outline of the book is the things which you've seen, chapter 1, the things which are, the letters to the seven churches, the things that shall be after this, beginning in chapter 4 and verse 1. And that's a helpful kind of way of thinking it through. But you'll notice in my outline, I've just adjusted that a little bit, because I've called chapter 1, verse 9 to chapter 3, verse, is it 21 or 22, the vision of the risen Christ among the churches. Because first of all, we see the risen Christ in chapter 1, verses 9 to 20, and then And it shows at that time he's standing in the middle of the lampstands. And then, from then on, the next seven parts of it are all letters to each of these seven churches. So the vision of this first part of chapter 1, verse 9, chapter 3, verse 21, with its two parts, the vision and then the things which are, is the Christ among his church, the Lord Jesus in the center of his people, the center of his church. Then from chapter 4 to chapter 22, verse 5, which is where this part ends, and then verse 6 begins the conclusion of it, you really have the things that shall be after this, the kind of center part. But that's such a big block of material. I've chosen to divide it into two. And I think John, in some way, divides it into two. Because if you look at chapter 4, verse 1, which I read, you don't need to specifically look at it. It says, I was in the Spirit, and I was caught up through a door into heaven. Then when you get to chapter 17, in verse 3, it talks again about being in the Spirit. So there seems to be a division between these two. So that's the big chunk of the book. And the major chunk, chapter 4 to chapter 16. Are you tracking with me here? I've lost some of you already if we're thinking through. But on the outline where it says, the Lamb and the scroll outpoured judgment. Chapters 4 and 5, John is taken into the heavenly court, into the presence of God in heaven. And there's first of all a vision of God on his throne, and then in chapter 5, the Lamb, the Lord Jesus, bearing the marks of slaughter, taking that, the scroll, which God is holding in his hand, which is the title deed to the earth. So this lays the foundation for everything that follows. There is going to come a time in which the Lamb, who is slain, who's conquered, as we'll see in that section, is going to step into active involvement in taking hold of the earth and making it his own. So I was working through chapter 11 today, and chapter 11 has this great point. Those of you who remember the Messiah and know it from that point will remember there's this great point in the Messiah: the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our God and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And all of that's anticipating that. Now, the way in which this section works from chapter 6 to verse 16, and I know this is a whole lot, but we'll go over this a lot so it'll keep in your head a little bit, is there's three judgments. And Jesus has taken the scroll, and he opens the scroll one seal at a time. So in chapter 6, he opens the six seals to open the scroll. And there's a pause in chapter 7. And then in chapter 8, the seventh seal is open and nothing happens. Matter of fact, it says there's silence in heaven for half an hour. And then, and I used the illustration and someone was kind enough to bring one, of a Russian doll. The first, or the seals, when you get to the seventh seal and you think you're finished, it turns out that there is, in fact, the seventh seal is a series of seven trumpets. So you have seven trumpet judgments that come. And they are, again, describing the period of time, which is right before the end. We'll come back to that a little bit later. And when we get to the seventh trumpet, same thing happens in that you think you've come to the end, and there's seven bowls within that. I think that's the end of this one, and it's the end of the book of Revelation, too, because there's seven. So that picture helped me a lot when I was trying to think it through. You have seven seals, but the seventh seal turns to be the kind of Russian doll. Out of it come the seven trumpets and the seven bowls, and they are all a series of judgments that are intensifying, and they all lead to the final point where Christ returns. Now, chapter 17, verse 1 to chapter 22, verse 5, we have a series of the last things. God is going to bring judgment on Babylon, which is the great system of evil. Chapter 19, Christ returns. Chapter 20, you have the kingdom of Christ reigns on the earth. You have the final judgment at the end of the chapter. And then you have the new heavens and the earth. And we're now into chapter 22 and verse 5. We'll get to that part sort of in due course. And then we have the conclusion. But if you think of the basic part, introduction, Christ among the churches, future things, or the things which shall be hereafter, conclusion, that's the way in which the book is put together. Now, any questions about that that you want to kind of help me make more obscure than I've tried at this point? Okay, then. So, in your outline, or in the notes that we're going to look at, here's where we're going to go. We talked last week about the author and John, who introduces himself by name, is John the Apostle, same as the writer of the Gospel of John and 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. This was recognized by the early church. The date of the book of Revelation is... By tradition, it was written in the time of Domitian, the emperor. He reigned from 81 to 96, but most and the early Christians believed it was toward the end, so we're probably at 95 AD in terms of when this book is written. John is a very old man at this particular time, especially in the light of, I can't really imagine what it's like to be 80 plus when you're talking about first century 80 plus. That's a lot different than now. But he's still serving the Lord. He's enough of a threat that the emperor's banished him to an island to get him out of the way. So he's still active. He's still serving the Lord, sort of like Caleb in the Old Testament. You know, I'm 80 years old. My strength hasn't gone. Give me this mountain and wanting to serve the Lord and do work for him. What kind of book is the book of Revelation? Turns out to be a far more important question than we can imagine, because all kinds of other things float around it. So look back at chapter 1, verse 1. And this may seem to be an obvious thing, but I just want to point out that there are three terms that are here. First of all, the revelation of Jesus Christ. And then it says in verse 3, blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. And then verse 4, John to the seven churches that are in Asia. And that's the kind of term that is used to introduce a letter. So let's think about three words here. The first is the word revelation. The word revelation is the Greek word, and did I write it down in the notes? I did. Apocalypsis. And many of you have heard the book of Revelation called the Apocalypse, and sometimes that's simply a term for it. Apocalypse, the literal meaning of the word is unveiling. It is revealing something that has been hidden. It is an opening to something that hasn't been made known. And in and of itself, that's all it means, a revelation, an unveiling. There's a shifting that takes place at a certain point of time. So let me talk about that. In the year about 200 BC, a series of books began to be written by Jews and later by some Christian writers as well, that scholars today, and some of it developed and the term developed later than the New Testament. This is not what the word apocalypse meant, but they talk about apocalyptic literature. And maybe you've heard the term apocalyptic literature. And apocalyptic literature, the apocalypses that were written in the Jewish world, and John would have known about these, were books that were written. They were always without a name of a writer being attached. They were pseudonymous, however you say that word. They were written under a pseudonym. So they were... But they claimed to have insight into what was going on, and they used exotic imagery and symbolism. Now, exotic imagery and symbolism is also found in the books of the Old Testament, primarily in three of them. Daniel, first of all, Ezekiel, and Zechariah. So in those books, you will find this Daniel most of all, and he's the one that we're most familiar with. And Daniel especially, and Ezekiel, and Zechariah will use these images as a way of talking about the future. But the Jewish apocalyptic books were much more talking about present events under symbolic language. So an apocalyptic thing talked about things that were happening in phantasmagorical language, but they were really often talking about present history about the experience of the nation of Israel, about the struggles they were going through, about Antiochus Epiphanes, the Syrian leader who was causing such havoc, and these kind of things. And there are many people who read the book of Revelation and they see it as apocalyptic. Now, when it begins by saying a revelation of Jesus Christ, the word didn't have that connotation to it when John wrote it. It came to have that connotation later, but that's not bound up in the term. But there's no doubt there's similarities between Jewish apocalyptic kind of writings and the book of Revelation. That has led many people to read this and say, this is all symbolism, it's really allegory, and we'll come back to that in another period of time. But it's very important that when John finds a term to describe the book, he uses the word prophecy, not the word apocalyptic. So you'll notice in verse 3, blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. Now, when we're in the world of prophecy, we're in something else, and this is the way in which he ends the book in chapter 22. He'll say, behold, I'm coming soon. Blessed is the one who keeps the word of the prophecy of this book. Or in verse 10 of 22, don't seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is near. Or in verse 18 of chapter 22, I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book, if anyone adds to them, God will add to him the plagues described in this book. If anyone takes away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God will take away his share in the tree of life and in the holy city, which are described in this book. Five times, John describes the book as a prophecy. Now, the reason that's important is prophecy has a very set meaning in the Old Testament and in biblical terms. A prophecy is, in this kind of language, a foretelling of actual events that are going to come in history. It isn't an allegory of what's going on. It is a foretelling, sometimes in profoundly visionary language, using, you know, significant symbols like a valley of dead bones, and the spirit breathes over them, and dem bones, you know, they put on flesh and blood, and life has come into them, and they come into existence. Now, Ezekiel wasn't saying there's really going to be a cemetery that ceases to be a cemetery, and the bones are going to be regathered. What he was talking about was the rebirth of the nation of Israel, which looked like a dead boneyard. But God was going to keep his covenant and restore the nation. Now, that's the kind of Ezekiel symbolism that speaks into this. But it's talking about a real event. It's not simply an allegorical statement of the modern day. Do you understand the difference with that? Now, the third term that would describe the book is that it is a letter. So there's these letter parts of the book, and that's clear in chapter 1, verses 1 to 8. Chapter 2 and 3 are letters to existing churches which are present, and then the conclusion in chapter 22, verses 6 to the end of the chapter, I think it's verse 22 again, are all letters. So if we are to think about what kind of book is the book of Revelation, we are much more to think of it as a prophecy, which may have apocalyptic, that is, Ezekiel, Daniel, Zechariah influences, not apocalyptic in the Jewish sense of apocalyptic literature, which was talking about present historical events, but using these symbols. The beast in apocalyptic literature was Antiochus Epiphanes, a present-day person, but you were using code words to describe him. But Daniel talks about Antiochus Epiphanes 400 years before he comes and is describing an actual individual. Are you capturing the distinction that I'm trying to make here? So the book of Revelation describes itself as a prophecy. And we need to take that clear and think of it in terms of prophetic literature in biblical sense, but be prepared that it's going to be a Daniel kind of book more than it's going to be even an Isaiah kind of book, although Isaiah is quoted fairly often. So, questions, observations here?
Well, the apocalyptic, the way the Jews viewed it, is different than the way we view apocalyptic today, isn't it? So, if they viewed it, some current events, we don't view it as current events, we view it as something happening.
When we talk, tend to use the term apocalyptic today, we tend to mean the end of the age, the great scenarios of destruction, end time events. And you've got secular apocalyptics, and you've got Star Wars as a kind of an apocalyptic.
So it wouldn't be the same as the Jewish definition.
No. No. And this was not a Jewish definition that was current in the first century. This is more a scholars looking back on that literature calling it apocalyptic rather than they went around calling this apocalyptic kind of literature.
You know what century that they started doing that?
And you know, I have it in my notes somewhere, but I don't remember Tara specifically. And at this point, I won't rush through what I have to figure it out. I'm sorry. Okay, so if you'll notice at the bottom of the page, the main approaches to the book of Revelation. And over the course of Christian history, there's been four different kind of main approaches to the book of Revelation. And some of it comes out of what we just talked about. So let's just talk through them a little bit. I want to be fair to each one. And there's pieces of most of them, at least three of them, that you can say, there's a point to that. And there's other points where you say no, although I can accept part of it, I can't go there. So the first way of viewing it is what is called preterism. And preterism is basically the belief that the book of Revelation is describing events that are part of history, that they are describing the events basically surrounding, for most people, basically surrounding the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. Now, there's others who would say, yes, the destruction of Jerusalem and also the destruction of Rome at a later period of time, although that's pretty rare. Now, You've got two kinds here. You've got what are called full preterists and partial preterists, and I don't want to get into a major discussion of that. But you need to realize that for many, now you read this and you say the majority opinion of scholars is that preterism is the way the book of Revelation has to be interpreted. And that sounds a little bit intimidating until you realize that the vast majority of scholars are skeptics who do not believe in predictive prophecy. So by definition, John can't be talking about the future because you can't know anything about the future. And this is a way in which he is making a political coded statement to people in his time. Now, there are evangelicals who are preterists and some very strong people deeply committed to scripture. They obviously could take a different view entirely. It's not that they don't believe in predictive prophecy. They just believe that John was describing the events that were going on now in the first century and the destruction of Jerusalem. So full preterists, if they're really full, say all of these things that are in the book have already taken place. Even the new heavens and the new earth. The new heavens and the new earth is the church and what's present in the church today. Satan is bound. The resurrection has taken place. It's not a physical resurrection. And you begin to recognize here, and Christ has already come. Christ came in 70 AD when the city of Jerusalem was destroyed. and you begin to read that and think, that's not the most evident way of reading that particular thing. Now, partial preterists, that is, those who believe most of the book relates to 70 AD, this is, no evangelical can be a full preterist, because you end up denying basic things about the Christian faith and about what is said in the future. But partial preterists, men such as a very esteemed theologian and scholar like R.C. Sproul, some of you will know the name of R.C. Sproul, will say the main part of the book is about what happened in 70 A.D., but I do believe in chapter 20 they have trouble with, chapter 21 and 22 are talking about the future. So they will say at this point, although it isn't clear in the text exactly how they make that distinction, at least not clear to my skeptical eyes, we're talking about real events that took place. So the things like the scroll, for example, and the destruction of the book, the scroll is read in the book as God's divorce decree to the nation of Israel, and it is about the judgment on Israel in that time. Now, there's lots of things I would say about that, and clearly the book had relevance to the people in the time in which it lived, but it's very hard to read that the day of wrath is going to come and one-third of all the people on earth are going to be destroyed, and suddenly change it to say what was really a significant war for the people of Israel, but wouldn't have even made the headlines in most countries in the world. I mean, the destruction of Jerusalem was not a world-shattering event in terms of its thing. It just means you're recasting so much of the book into another language. You're forced not to take seriously when it says all the world, they will read it as meaning all the land of Israel and put that in brackets. So preterism is, to my mind, a very difficult one to sustain, especially if the book is written in 95 AD, and it claims to be a prophecy. What's prophetic about what something happened 20 years ago? Some of them will say, no, it was written in 68 AD, and so they will move around. It was really written before these events occurred, but that has other serious problems with it. So a second view here is historicism. Now, that's not the best term for it, but this view is that the book is using language of what is going to happen in the history of the church over the course of time. And this became a significant, after a certain point in history, and I don't need to go into it, but after basically Augustine made kind of allegorical interpretation the fundamental thing in terms of doing it, you then began to read it through current events and try to say, oh, this particular bowl must be that particular invasion, and this must be this. By the time the Reformation came, and actually this idea had come out of Roman Catholic circles, but the idea came that the Pope is the Antichrist, Babylon in the book is the city of Rome, and the whole system that's there is the papacy and all of the medieval church that was part of that. And the book is really describing the overthrow of the Pope and the overthrow of Catholicism in the Protestant Reformation and the setting up of all that's going to happen at that particular time. Well, the trouble is that now we are, to 500 years almost. Interesting to think of that, isn't it? That 3 years from now we'll celebrate when Martin Luther, 500 years earlier, had nailed the 95 Theses to the door in Wittenberg. So almost 500 years after that, and you think, well, what about the rest of the time of history? And the trouble is, if you're trying to read it as historical events and you read history to find it, nothing really fits and nobody agrees about anything, about what Babylon is or what Babylon is, because there's no controls. It's just whatever your imagination has to say. So there's very, very, very few historicists now. That view really kind of there's a little bit of remnant, and you'll find some pockets of strong anti-Catholic Catholicism in Protestant circles, but they're more convinced of their anti-Protestantism than they are of the text of the book of Revelation, if I can put it that way. The third view is idealism. And idealism says that the book of Revelation is not talking about specific events. It is an allegorical depiction of timeless spiritual principles. It is a little bit like John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress. It isn't talking about something specific. It's saying something more general. One of the individuals who's written on that says, the book teaches lessons such as, we need to live heroic, faith-filled lives. We need to endure under persecution. We need to remember history is in God's hands. We need to know that Satan will always oppose God, and people will always oppose God. We need to know that evil will in the end be doomed. We need to know of Christ's sovereignty. And I say, I think all of those truths are taught in the book of Revelation. But I don't think that's what the book of Revelation is about. It's talking much more specifically about that. And the only way you get to those generalizations is to ignore all the details. The problem with idealism is not what it affirms, it's what it ignores. That John is talking prophecy. And if you think of all of the prophecies in the Old Testament, when Isaiah said, a young woman will conceive and bring forth a son, she wasn't saying, you know, women give birth all the time and children are the hope of the world. That's not what that prophecy meant. It meant that there was going to be a baby born in a miraculous way and so forth. So the problem of idealism, and there's many times when we need to read it, and one of the questions is, if this is really talking about the future, then how do we apply it and what relevance does it have to our life now? And it's at that point you step back and say, you know, it does teach us to expect opposition. It does call us to endurance. It does say that Satan, because everything that happens in the book of Revelation, or almost everything, except for God's direct intervention, is part of the spiritual warfare we find ourselves in, the spiritual realities. It's just that on steroids in a particular way. So the fourth view of the book is futurism. And this says the book, although different parts relate specifically, such as chapter 2 and 3, to the past in an ongoing way, just like all of the books of the New Testament. I mean, the book of Corinthians was written to the Corinthians. That church doesn't exist anymore, but the truth of Corinthians is still with us. So chapters 2 and 3 of the book of Revelation are written to actual churches, and they apply to us. But when John is called up to heaven in chapter 4, verse 1, and he's told, I will show you things that will happen after these things, he is talking about the events that will culminate on earth at the end of history when Christ physically returns to earth as he promised. I find it utterly astonishing that someone can say Christ returned in 70 AD, because the promise in Acts was this same Jesus will return in like manner as you've seen him depart. And nobody saw this same Jesus standing on the Mount of Olives in 70 AD. He did not physically return, but he's going to physically return. And the promises of both of John and, pardon me, of Revelation and of the Old Testament are going to be fulfilled in the physical return of Christ. So futurism is the view that the book applies to the future. Now, there are differences in it, and there are those who would call themselves historical futurists, who sees much of it applying down through church history. But you reach a certain point. For example, look with me in Revelation chapter 6 for just a moment. And part of the challenge is going to be, as we move through the book of Revelation, how seriously do we take what is actually said if there are not clear directions that they are in some way symbolic? So, sorry, I keep fooling myself by where I have my glasses along here. We're in the seals, and one of the, I keep thinking, when you talk about the seven seals of the book of Revelation, we're talking about seals on a document, not seals you see down at the beach, just in case any of you were. And when we get to chapter 6, we're going to see there's lots of questions about when do the seals start? Have they already started? And we'll look at the first one. But when we get to the fourth seal, when he opened the book, I heard the, verse 7, I'm sorry. When he opened this fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature come, saying, "Come." And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and its rider's name was Death, and Hades following him. And they were given authority over a quarter of the earth to kill with sword and with famine and with pestilence and by wild beasts of the earth. Now, if we take that at all seriously, look back and say, when did anything like that happen in history? I mean, a quarter of the population of the earth killed. And at that point, I'm beginning to be forced to believe somewhere we've crossed the line into end time events, which are far beyond anything we can go back in history and look at. The fifth seal is in the same vein. If you notice, we're anticipating where we're going to get. But it said, he opened the fifth seal, and I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they'd borne. They cried out with a loud voice. Actually, I wanted to go down to the sixth one, so let me jump over that. Verse 12. He opened the sixth seal. I looked, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth. The full moon became like blood, and the stars of the sky fell to the earth. Now, all of that is going to cause some questions that we have to wrestle with. The sky vanished like a scroll that's rolled up, and every mountain and island was removed from its place. And the generals of the earth and the great ones and the kings of the earth and the great ones and the generals and the rich, the powerful and everyone, slave and free, hid themselves in the caves among the rock and among the rocks of the mountains, calling to the mountains and the rocks, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who's seated on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand?" And it's my belief that we've crossed the line into what, to use shorthand language, Jesus described as after the tribulation there will come, or after these things, there will come great tribulation such as has not been nor ever will be again. And I think the biblical evidence points to this, to being in the last 3.5 years before the Lord comes to earth. So futurism is talking most specifically the book of Revelation about the final end time events, focused especially on that last 3.5 years before Christ, or during which Christ is pouring out judgment on the earth. It is, to use Jesus' term, the Great Tribulation period. Now, one of the questions is, what's the relationship of Christians to this particular time? And we'll talk about that on another occasion. But I am a futurist, as I understand the book of Revelation, and understand it to be talking about future events. But over and over, we're going to have to say, but this has something to say to us here and now, and to see its present application, although there's a future direction. Now, questions, observations. Kathleen. I'm having trouble hearing. I'm sorry.
preteritism or whatever.
Preterism?
Yeah. Is that kind of where they, I mean, I don't understand, like, you're showing these examples of how they, these things haven't happened. So do they somehow manipulate it to make it seem like it happened?
Well, they read it as spiritual things. Israel was judged. God destroyed the nation of Israel in an act of judgment, and he gave the promises of Israel over to the church. So they see that has happened spiritually.
But there's all these details. What? How can they, you know, say that, like, a third of the people die, or the grass, and you know, the water? And
they say that that's apocalyptic literature, which is characterized by exaggeration.
A redundant kind of comment, but it's strange that people who have clear understanding of the hermeneutic for the rest of the Bible, and they would take Daniel and Ezekiel and Zechariah and see it and interpret it what we would say in common normal lines to explain something. They would throw that out when you get to Revelation. It doesn't
make
sense.
Well, they read it back into the Old Testament. The standard hermeneutic, particular view, and I'm not trying to... standard hermeneutic is that what happened in Christ has changed the way we need to read the Old Testament as well and God's promises to Israel. That while God made promises to Israel, God always intended to do something greater than that. And so the promises made to Israel have been transcended. They would say, it's as if you promised your grandson, a motor scooter when they reached a certain age, and instead presented them with a high-powered sports car. What has happened in Christ is so superior to what was promised in the Old Testament that we have to read the Old Testament in a different way. So, okay, I want to press on because I didn't expect to take this long with this part, and I haven't even got to the back page yet, but I can do this one a little bit faster than the other one. The Old Testament and the book of Revelation. All I want to say here is that you cannot understand the book of Revelation without being aware that the Old Testament is the place from which it is drawing its resources. The book of Daniel, the book of Ezekiel, the book of Zechariah are really important backdrop. And there will be times in which there are simply allusions to that and we're expected to know. One of the interesting things is the Old Testament is never directly quoted in the book of Revelation. And yet, if you look through the different references to it, and this depends on how you're counting it. I think I mentioned last week, there are at least 300 different allusions to the Old Testament, and they just come up at all kinds of different times. I was reading chapter 11 earlier, yesterday, and it talks about the two witnesses come in the last time and said, these are the two olive trees. And you think, the two olive trees? What in the world is that all about? Well, that's all about Zechariah chapter 4. And I think you better figure out what Zechariah and the two olive trees are all about and how that fits in. And the fact that there he goes to say, it's not by might, it's not by power, it's by my spirit, which comes out of that particular passage. And it's just full of this. Jesus calls himself the morning star. Where does that come? It comes from the Old Testament. So over and over, we'll find ourselves being pressed to go back and look at the Old Testament for some of these things. That's where it primarily comes from. Symbolism and the book of Revelation. Again, we can be relatively quick here. One set of symbolism, and it's pretty common, is the use of numbers. Now, this gets to be a bit of a challenge because I said this last time, that numbers can be both symbolic and actual. And the obvious illustration is there are 12 apostles. There really were 12 apostles. But that was symbolic of the fact that Israel was built around 12 tribes, and Jacob had had really 12 sons. And so 12 is a symbolic number of some significance in the book, and multiples of 12. The most important number symbolically and actually in the book of Revelation is the number 7. And the number 7 is, as is commonly said, the number of completeness, the number of God. So we already had it, the seven seals, the seven trumpets, the seven bowls. Another passage talks about the seven thunders that come. You have seven churches, and you just have that number used fairly consistently. I think 54 times the number 7 is used, and so we get into that. The number 12, which I just mentioned, and multiples of the number 12. So you've got 12 gates to the city, you've got 12 tribes, you've got 144,000, 12 times 12, with 12,000 coming from each of the tribes, and so you've got that number. Another number that's important is the number 4. You'll have 4 living creatures, 4 corners of the earth, 4 winds. That has about the idea of universal kind of connection. Oh, at 12, you've got 24 elders that are mentioned. So what are they? 7, 12, 4, 10 is another number of importance. In the Old Testament, obviously, you have 10 commandments. But you have 10 mentioned a number of different times in the book, so I don't need to go into that. Now, there's all kinds of other symbols in the book. So let me just talk more here directly about symbols and how they occur. I put them in 4 different categories. There are symbols that come from the Old Testament. So let me just give a few that are obvious ones. The lion of the tribe of Judah. The lamb that was slain. If you don't know the Old Testament, you'll never figure out what those things are all about. Incense becomes important in different places. The altar, which refers to the incense altar. 24 elders. Well, there were 24 courses of priests in the Old Testament. The tree of life. The hidden manna. They were lying in the city, who symbolically is named Sodom and Gomorrah. At the end of time, people will align with Satan, Gog and Magog, and the great city Babylon. All of those come out of the Old Testament. And so that's one of the questions you need to ask. Is this a biblical symbol? Other symbols are interpreted within the book itself. So I have a full page here on these notes that I have about symbols that are in the book. The 7 lampstands, well, we read they're the 7 churches. The 7 stars, they're said to be 7 angels. The morning star, he's said to be Christ. The 7 churches are said to be the sevenfold spirit. The 7 eyes are the sevenfold spirit. Incense are the prayers of God's people. The fallen star is the angel of the abyss. The great city Sodom and Gomorrah is said to be Jerusalem. And it goes on and on. The book will often tell us. The verse I didn't read. At the end of chapter 1, remember how I skipped that over? Well, it says, as for the mystery of the 7 stars you saw in my hand and the 7 gold lampstands, the 7 stars are the angels of the 7 churches, and the 7 lampstands are the 7 churches. So John, every now and then, will just help us out and say, here's what that symbol that you pondered was all about. It was meaning this. A third kind is symbols. What order did I put here? Symbols from the first century world. Well, the major one that I thought of, and I didn't go through it in very in depth, but there's a city on 7 hills. Well, city on 7 hills is really hard to distinguish from Rome. I mean, that's just been its kind of name going on. And then there's other symbols that are derived from the natural world. locusts, scorpions, horses, animals of prey, the lion, bear, eagle, leopard, vulture, thunder, lightning, smoke, all of those are connotations which are fairly self-interpreting because they come from the natural world, and John isn't doing anything exotic with them. He's really simply using them on their own. Now, let's just end with this. I want to dwell on the middle one of these. I could have chosen a whole bunch of important themes in the book of Revelation, but the first two are really central. The first is that over and over in the book of Revelation, God is portrayed as the sovereign and righteous judge. He is the one who sits on the throne. And the word throne is used 46 times in the book of Revelation. That's how God is described, the one who sits on the throne. Now, here's where you have something else going on, and you need to think in the first century world. For the people sitting in the first century world, they were being told to call Domitian God and Lord, Dominus et Deus Noster, our God and Lord. And when John keeps referring to God as the one who sits on the throne, he is making a hidden political statement. There are implications to that. Caesar's not God. Caesar's not Lord. And history is not in the hands of Caesar, because these Christians were under pressure to go into one of the Roman temples and offer a sacrifice or an offering to Domitian. They weren't required to believe in him in any meaningful way, but to do obeisance to him, symbolic refuge. So the book is reminding us that God is sovereign, and it also that he is just. And there's going to be this great theme, we've already had it, fall on us and save us from God and all his judgment and from the wrath of the Lamb. So that becomes a dominant theme within the book, God's justice, and there will be singing related to that over and over. Now, the second thing I just want to quickly notice is what is said about the Lord Jesus. First of all, look with me at chapter 1. And verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who was and who is and is to come, the Almighty. Keep your finger there and turn to chapter 21, verse 6. And he who is seated on the throne said, Behold, I'm making all things new. Also he said, Write this down, for the words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the springs of the water of life without payment. He who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God. They will be my people. Now, in both of those cases, God himself, the one who sits on the throne, is speaking. Right? So look at chapter 22 and verse 12. Behold, I am coming soon. Who's coming soon in the book of Revelation?
Jesus.
The Lord Jesus. Bringing my recompense with me to repay everyone for what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. But that was the title that God himself took in chapter 21. It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. But now Jesus uses those exact same words. Back in chapter 1, in verse 17, he's just had this vision of Jesus. And he said, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, 'Fear not, I am the first and the last,'" which is the same as Alpha and Omega, first and last letter of the Greek alphabet. "And the living one, I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore." But when we read chapter 21 and verse 5 or verse 6, "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end." Jesus has exactly the same titles as God the Father has. And that's extremely important in terms of the Christology of the book. I can remember one of the times we were back in Calgary, and one of our folks had got involved with some Jehovah's Witnesses who were bothering them, so they asked me to come over and meet with them and with this couple of Jehovah's Witnesses who were doing the rounds. And we had a fairly significant going back and forth. And then they weren't happy with that, how that one went. So they called in the head guy for the Jehovah's Witnesses to meet the next time. And Elizabeth came along to that one. I can still remember her comment being, "You were pretty adversarial." Well, the reality was I was so angry from the last time about how they distorted Scripture. And how when they got into a tough spot, they would just read their notes. And I said, no, read the passage. But what I found really fascinating was they were prepared for a lot of the arguments, but they weren't prepared for the book of Revelation. And they just sort of, well, it can't mean that. But it does mean that. Both Jesus and God the Father declare themselves, "I am the first and the last. I am the Alpha and Omega. I am the beginning and the end." Now, look at chapter 22 and verse 1. What do you notice in chapter 22 and verse 1? "The river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb." They are sharing the throne. Or look with me at chapter 5. "Worthy," verse 12 of chapter 5, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." By the way, how many descriptions are of the Lamb are there? How many adjectives are used? Seven. You think that's an accident that there are seven attributes? Okay, now look at chapter 7. And verse 11, "All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, 'Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.'" Read them. Seven adjectives. Six of them are exactly the same as what was used back in chapter 5. And exactly the same words are used to describe or affirm praise to God. The difference is in chapter 7, the word thanksgiving is used. He's worthy to receive thanksgiving. And in verse 11, I think it's, or 12, is it blessing? I don't remember which is the... No. Anyway, it's one of the words. You can... Sorry? I know it's verse 12, but there's one word that's different. Wealth? Is it wealth? Okay. But clearly, that's not a significant difference. So, the Christology of the book of Revelation is higher than any book in the New Testament in terms of its direct affirmation of the person of Christ. Now, what else did I have here in your notes? And we'll just draw this to an end because time has gone. The person and work of Christ. Well, I just want to, obviously, if we're talking about the work of Christ, the major thing is he is the Lamb. The Lamb who is slain. The Lamb, I like to translate it, the Lamb bearing the marks of slaughter. So he's risen, but he's the Lamb bearing the marks of slaughter. The word Lamb is used 28 times as a title of Jesus, or is it 29? One of those two in the book of Revelation. It is the main title of Jesus. He is the Lamb. And it isn't exactly the same Greek word that's used. One uses Arnion and the other one uses Amnos. I know, Theus, I'm saying it wrong, but it's always nice to have a native speaking Greek here when you... But Margarita hasn't ever come and corrected me. It's Theus. And I'm always grateful that she does, because I didn't learn to speak it properly. Before I got so distracted by myself. They use a different term, but behind it is John 1:29 of John the Baptist's statement, "Behold the Lamb of God who bears away the sins of the world." Now, there's one other thing, and I already read it, but it always sends a kind of chill down my spine when I read it, because on one level, it is so out of character. But you remember when I read chapter 6, verse 16? "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who is seated on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb." Now, lambs are not especially things you need to be afraid of. But the wrath of the Lamb is something entirely different. And it's really interesting that John doesn't say the wrath of the Lion of Judah. It's the wrath of the Lamb. Because Christ will be vindicated as the slain one. But while he is the Savior who died, he is also the King who rules. And if you can put it this way, the Lamb becomes a ram. Horns, he's depicted as having horns because he's the powerful one. Well, there's a bunch of passages on worship. We're not going to have time to go that. Let me just see if there's anything that I left you in the dust with that you want to see. Steve or Connor, we'll get it at home, okay? So thank you for putting your hand up. Well, you can, okay, you've had your hand up earlier. Yes.
Wouldn't predators say that Jesus came to earth spiritually, not physically?
Yeah, the question was, would a preterist say that Jesus came to earth physically and not spiritually and not physically? That's exactly what they say in 70 AD. But the angel said they would see him physically when he returned and not just spiritually. So, okay. Well, I think I'd like to pray here, and let's conclude that way. Father, thank you for giving us your word, stretching our minds with it, but most of all, challenging us to bow the knee before the truth of who your Son is, our Lord and Savior, in whose name we give you thanks. In Christ's name, amen. So next week, we're going to look at the actual book of Revelation, first 8 verses of chapter 1.